Fast forward a few thousand years, we've gotten sophisticated and intelligent, and we have come to compartmentalize a lot of times our Christianity to where this is spiritual and this is secular. They didn't get that distinction. When I say everything, from the time they got up to the time they went to bed, their life was directed by God. We have our jobs. And our job is secular. That's got nothing to do with Christianity. That's got nothing to do with, that's not a spiritual phenomenon, that's a secular phenomenon. This is where I work in. So how I interact with my boss or how many packs of paper and pencils I take home from the job, take to my kids, doesn't necessarily register as not Christian. Because we see this is secular and this is spiritual. How I interact with my wife and how I treat her and how I treat my kids, that's what I do at home. That ain't got nothing to do with church. That ain't got nothing necessarily to do with what they talk about. This is secular. And when I come to church, that's when it's time to be spiritual. And our lifestyle, our interaction with God is compartmentalized a lot of times to paying the bills is secular. That's not spiritual. Letting myself be taken care of when I am fully capable of working is secular. That's not spiritual. Israel didn't have that distinction. Everything about who they were and the way that they acted and the way they conducted themselves was defined by the word. He also gives them a revelation of who he is when he's instilling in them how they were supposed to act. He also shows them, he sets up a series of nine feasts that they're supposed to keep when he's defining who they're supposed to be. And in those feasts, he is showing them, or he shows them, that he is both creator and redeemer or deliverer, and keeps them and institutes that as a part of who they are, so that way, as they go about their life and as they live their life, they have a clear revelation and understanding of who God is or who he has shown himself to be up to that point. And that was ingrained in who their identity was. That was a part of who they were, and then gives them a place to worship or establishes a tabernacle. And eventually they build a temple. By the time this stuff is being written, the temple was in place. But it was a place where you would go to be able to interact with God, have your relationship with God, and also restore the relationship that you had with God if you had fallen out of favor with him. So in defining who they were, God gives them an identity and a picture of who they're supposed to become. He gives them a vision of who he's supposed to be and dictates how they're supposed to interact and relate to him and deal with him. And that is what it meant for those people to become a biblical people. One of the things that I think is interesting and funny when you look at the tabernacle and you look at the temple is that they didn't have pews. There were no seats in the tabernacle or the temple because of what was in the tabernacle and the temple. And the tabernacle and the temple was the Ark of the Covenant. And the Ark of the Covenant was representative of God, and they understood that when we see this, we're looking for all intents and purposes at a representation of where God is sitting, and we're not going to be in the presence of God and sit down and have lost your natural mind. If I'm in the presence of God, I'm either standing up or I'm in reverence or bowing down in worship. What do we need these? If we look at folks now, the ones who standing up on service, what is wrong with them? It was the exact opposite back then. If you were sitting down, you might have tossed out, at the very least. But that's how they get stuff. I understand we've moved on, and we've become much more intelligent, and technology has advanced and everything. But that was their attitude and their mindset, that when they went to the temple of God, when they went to the place where they were going to worship God, as they ascended up, as they made their way up the mountain, there were songs that they sang on their way to the house, so that way when they got in the house, their mindset was already defined or in such a way that they understood they were in the presence of God. It was a different kind of people, a biblical people whose entire existence was defined and their entire identity flowed from God's Spirit and his Word. And so everything that they did, there was nothing about who they were that wasn't defined by God. And so when we look at the book of Psalms and we look at the praises of God's people, and we understand by experience, we understand by observation, we understand by study that there is an inherent prayer power that comes with praise. We have to keep in mind that the people that we saw that power manifest from had a different kind of relationship with God than what the Western mindset oftentimes allows. They were totally engrossed in God. They were totally consecrated. a natural extension or outgrowth or manifestation of a supernatural relationship. And so although we understand and we want to see the powerful manifestation of God in the songs we sing and our clapping of our hands, a lot of times we don't necessarily think, where does that power come from? The power of my praise stems from the relationship that I have with God. And as my relationship with God becomes more complete and becomes more powerful, then I can tap into, because praise reorients my mind, refocuses, allows me to tap into a strength that I've already established before I got into it. And so we get to the 107th Psalm, where it opens up with, oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good and his mercy endures forever. This psalm is considered by some people a part of the Halal Psalm book, or the final division of the book of Psalms. Like I said, classified as a Halal Psalm. And the thing I like about this particular psalm, and what spoke to me from this, is that it is cyclical, and there's almost a symmetry to it. And by that I mean, each one of the five passages that we read starts with, oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, and his mercy endures forever. Or, oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, and for his mighty works in the earth, to his people. So the way that this is set up when you read the entire psalm is it starts, oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, and his mercy endures forever. Then it goes through and begins to detail stuff that he's done. A few verses later, you look back and it says, oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, and for all that we would praise him for his goodness and his mighty works. And then it would list a few more verses, talk more about what he's done. Then it gets back to, oh, give that men would praise him for his goodness and his mighty works. And then it lists a whole bunch of other works. And the thing about it that you see is that in every testimony they give, it takes us back to the original idea that God is a good God. Everything that they list takes us back to and points to the goodness of God. Fast forward a few thousand years, we're more intellectual now. We've attached a lot of addendums and provisos and expectations and about what praise is supposed to be. But what you see in this psalm is that everything that's being done points back to God's goodness. Every testimony that's given points back to the nature of God. We have become a culture that is obsessed about what is in God's hand rather than looking at his face. A biblical praise points back to God's face and his nature. It's not born out of what I need at the time. You will hear and you see. The praise doesn't become powerful because the preacher decides I'm going to go to the mountaintop and tell you that if you need something from God, give him a crazy praise. That's not what makes the praise powerful. The praise is powerful because it stems from my relationship with God and points back to his nature and his goodness. That's where the power of my praise comes from. That's what makes it effective. When we look at Israel, when we look at the praises that they had, the way God worked and the way God blessed, you found them in a mindset that was consecrated and committed to who God intended them to be. And so when they went about to do the work of God, and he said, make a loud noise, the noise that they made and what they were supposed to declare was who God was. The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, and the God of Moses. And they make a loud noise to declare who it is that's about to mess up your day. Or, as we deal with it now, guys, you got somebody watching over you. You want me to tell you who it is? That is the power of praise. Comes in being able to demonstrate and show people that God is good. That's why when we come together corporately, we all have different stories. But our testimony boils down to the same thing. Sister Graham, you go through what you go through in a week. I go through something completely different. Brother Douglas goes through something totally different. When we get together and think about everything that God has done for us, the conclusion we come to is that God is a good God. Once upon a time, that fact in and of itself was enough to get folks excited and burn the church down. Now we've gotten eloquent, now we've gotten articulate, our vocabulary is expanding a lot more, and we look for, I'm going to give a crazy praise because I need something from God. Where it's not a bargaining chip to be able to get something out of God, we gather and our focus drifts away from God's goodness. We have to keep in mind that God's not good because we're blessed. because God is good. The source of my blessings come from the nature of God. And when